Hey, this is Captoffy Banzai. Today we're going to look at a 3D printed motion time-lapse device. Tried it out quite a bit. You'll see the examples in this video. My friend Pat printed this out for me. So thanks to him, we're going to get a chance to check this out. It's on Thingiverse, the username PrintFail. See, his actual name is Fernando Rossi. He has a few examples of his own. It's comprised of two pieces, one for the GoPro style mount, and then also one to hold the egg timer, which you have to buy to use in this. I have a link in the description to the one that we used in this example. You also need a 608 bearing. You can find those with skateboards or just any type of online on Amazon. I don't remember the exact one in this case, but they're pretty easy to find. There are some quirks with this device. It could use some revisions with the print. I'm going to read off what my friend Pat had issue-wise. He said the biggest problem he had printing was with adhesion between the layers, especially on the small spindle for the camera. That's where the bearing attaches to. He said it would break at the very base of the stem with little to no effort. He said do not try to wind the lapser with the two pieces connected together. Wind it itself and then attach them afterwards. Otherwise, you'll have a good chance of breaking something on here. He also mentioned with the bearing, you want to have a piece of electrical tape wrapped around this connection point because it is a little loose. Just something there to make it a little tighter so it doesn't wobble when it's moving. A few quirks I've noticed so far is that the egg timer makes some noise, of course. It clicks while it's rotating and it also does the buzzer thing. I tried putting some tape around it, but it didn't really help a whole lot. You're just going to have some noise. He also already cracked one of these connection points with the GoPro mount. It is 3D printing. There's not a lot of flexibility to this type of plastic, so you have to be careful when you tighten up the connection point. Of course, I'm going to fix this with some glue, but just things to keep in mind. So I did quite a few examples with this setup. It was fun to take out and use. Of course, you do have to invest quite a bit of time to doing time lapses because it takes some time. In this case, I have my Maba ME10 action camera. It's just a generic third-party action camera. I have the full-size photos in this case, but I did render them in 1080p with ffmpeg software. Let's just go over the software a little bit. I was using ffmpeg. It's a command line tool. It's relatively easy to use once you have the commands set up. Of course, I'll show you that on the screen. The main thing to keep in mind with this command is how many frames you want to use per second. So in this case, I was using between 18 and 24, depending on how many frames I had of the time lapse itself. So depending on how many frames I was able to take with this time lapse setup, I would use either 18 or 24. With the action camera itself, I was using 3-second intervals. That does not have any relation to ffmpeg and what frames per second I was using in that. Really, I just tried out 3 seconds for the first initial time lapse and it worked pretty well, so I just wanted to stick with that for these examples. Of the description page of the 3D printed device, he says that it is a reduction ratio of 4 to 1, so 1 hour of time lapse can rotate 90 degrees. I took this device out 3 different times, a few different examples for each one. For the first outing, I took it to Peace Park, one of my favorite little parks in Rockford area, to get some action, get some motion. I know there's a large road, quick fast road that I thought would be good. Did work out pretty well with the angle that I found. I didn't have any type of way to mount this on a tripod, which is something to really think about in the future because I was using a lot of lower angles. Getting roadways in this setup, in this situation, is not ideal. But in this specific case, it worked pretty well. And thankfully, there were a lot of clouds that day that were really interesting looking and added a lot to that specific time lapse. For the second outing, I did quite a few time lapses on this one. Some of these really didn't work out too well, but we're going to get to that. The first one, I was at a Sonic Drive-In, which is basically a restaurant that you can park at and you can eat your food in the car. In this case, I had the time lapse in my car facing a busy street again. This actually worked out better than the first one, I think, because you could see the cars up close, and there's just a lot of action. So that's pretty interesting. In the second one, I was trying to, again, get some motion with cars, but in this case, it really didn't work out too well. This thing really does need some type of tripod connection. I'd probably be taping it to a tripod head in the future just so I can get that functionality out of it. So in this case, I was on the ground in a brush area and the angle was not correct. So it just looked kind of goofy, but it is what it is. Definitely good practice. For this next one, it was similar to the previous one in that the device was on the ground. But in this case, the clouds looked more interesting and I was in the frame for some of the beginning. But I could see that being pretty interesting for doing some type of photography outside. You're in the frame the entire time. This last one was my favorite of the day. There's a large structure at this park. There's a huge open window. It's just basically a hole in the structure. I could put the device on, just leave it there. It has a really nice view. I got the full extended time lapse in that setup. As long as the clouds work out, it could be really interesting right there. For the third outing, I have two different time lapses that are very similar. The first one, I messed up how the cog was placed, so I didn't get the full extension. But the clouds were really nice in that first time lapse at the Rock Hut State Park. The second one is basically a follow-up with an adjustment to the device so I could get the full extension. And very similar, but we're going to put some music on that one. You can check out. The biggest takeaway here is trying to find good spots for time lapses. In this case, with this specific device, I really want to mount some type of tripod connection to it. Tripod head, I'll just tape it on there, whatever works, but I really want that extension. I don't want to put things in the ground all the time, and I want to level it off so that it is straight with roadways and whatever else I'm trying to frame in the time lapse. All that said, it's a fun little device. It's relatively cheap to try out. If you know someone that has a 3D printer, see if they can make it for you. This thing does need some revisions in the print to make it perfect, but with a little effort, a little TLC, you can make it work well enough. Again, thanks to my friend Pat for printing this out for me and the person that made the model. Really interesting low-cost device to try out with the motion time-lapse stuff. It's fun to add that extra dynamic to those time-lapse videos. Hope you enjoyed this video. I'm Scott from Photography Banzai. If you did enjoy the video, please consider subscribing. That helps me out a lot. Likes and shares help out a lot as well. Thanks again. As I mentioned, you're going to spend a lot of time just waiting for the thing to work. And I did some Pokemon Go in that area because that's a big hotspot for that stuff. So good area to do some Pokemon Go and also motion time lapse.